So without further ado, and thank you guys for staying with me as we are running a little behind, I want to introduce Carlos Gil. So Carlos Gil is the author of The End of Marketing, Humanizing Your Brand in the Age of Social Media and AI. He is an international keynote speaker. We're so lucky to have him. He flew in just before the storm, thank God. And he's an award-winning digital storyteller with over a decade of experience leading social media strategy for global brands, including LinkedIn, Winn-Dixie, Save-A-Lot, and BMC Software. Gil is the CEO and founder of Gil Media, a full-service digital marketing firm based in Los Angeles, which works with Fortune 500 clients. His work has been featured in CNN Money, Harvard Business Review, and Entrepreneur Magazine, and Social Media Examiner. Outside, we have copies of Carlos Gil's new book, which he will be signing at the break. We're not going to have time for onstage Q&A with Carlos, so definitely rush out at the break and get your book, get your signature, and ask him questions. All right, guys, let's put our hands together for Carlos.
Today's consumer doesn't want to be sold to on Facebook any more than they enjoy watching a commercial on their television. As social media has evolved, customers have evolved as well. Social networks today are much different than what they were 10 years ago. Today, they are publicly traded corporations which are in business to monetize their user data. Therefore, to have a chance at winning through social media marketing, you need to understand the rules and play within the boundaries of each social network. Social media isn't free, and it's not new anymore. It's a business. You need to find ways to stand out. In this presentation, I'm going to show you how to get the most out of social media for your business and teach you proven methods to make you a better marketer, grow your thought leadership, and create more engaging content for your business. No different than music moguls Drake and DJ Khaled. Now, I'm sure you've heard or seen the Shiggy Challenge, which to date has earned a whopping 7.3 million views on Instagram. Imagine when you add up everyone on the internet who participated, including Will Smith, Ciara, and Odell Beckham Jr., how many more views have been generated for the In My Feelings song, which has over 200 million views on YouTube today? People are brands. You are competing for attention against other corporations and also real people. Let's begin.
About 9 now, right? Trap, money, penny. This shit got me in my feelings. Gotta be real with you. Yep. Woo! Kiki, do you love me? Are you riding?
What's good? How's everyone doing this morning? Ready to get lit here at Social Media Week? Look, I just came from Los Angeles, where it's not snowing, and it's really warm. So as you can see, I don't have any socks on, so you know I'm bringing the fire. It is so good to be here in Toronto. It is actually my first time in Canada, so thank you so much to the team. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much to all of you for being here today. Thank you so much to the team at Social Media Week for inviting me. I'm really excited to spend the next hour talking to you about the end of marketing. So congrats, welcome to the end of marketing. By a very quick show of hands, how many of you over the last year participated in the In My Feelings Challenge? Come on, we're in Toronto. Did the In My Feelings Challenge not make it here when it was Drake who sang the song? How many of you are? Let me ask you this question. How many of you over the last year saw someone that you know doing the dance that was just on the screen? Almost all of you. So kudos to Drake for getting people to jump out of moving cars just to flex for the gram, right? Marketing today is about moments. You just heard Michelle talk about the new influencers today. The new celebrity is an everyday person, which is really the thesis of my book, The End of Marketing, and the content I'm gonna share with you here today about humanizing your brand and how you can be a savage marketer and how you can do all the things that all these influencers and celebrities are doing. But you need to stop and analyze for just one moment what marketing has really become. It's become a moment in time. It's become an event. It's become a song. It's become a challenge. Because the reality is that today's consumer is leveraging social media not only to connect with friends, to consume content, but to be cool. Now, on the screen behind me, you see some examples of some different challenges. These might be challenges that you've participated in personally or seen someone that you know participate over the last few years. We had the Ice Bucket Challenge. We had the Shiggy Challenge. We've had the 10-year FaceApp Challenge, the Facebook Challenge. Like, all these challenges take place. How many of you have participated in a challenge? Ever? Look around. And why is that? Because you want to be a part of something. You want to be a part of something cool. You want your friends to see that you're a part of this moment. And that's not marketing, that's moments. What most corporate entities fail to recognize is that on social media, it's the inmates who run the asylum. It's the end user who has all the power and the control. Not a billion-dollar corporation, but an everyday person. See, every single person in this audience right now is an influencer. That's the way I see all of you. Every single person here who has a cell phone right now, who has the ability to tweet, the ability to Instagram, you all have power. You all have influence. And you see, the challenge that we as marketers face as brands is how to sift through all this digital noise that's being created at a rapid rate every single second of the day. Now, with that being said, how many of you are on Twitter? Almost all of you? Okay. Instagram? All right. I wouldn't expect anything less at a social media conference. Here's what I want you to do, not just throughout my session, but throughout this conference. If you learn something, if you learn something new, if there's a stat, there's something cool that you want to share out, make sure that you tweet it out, Instagram it. Make sure you tag me at CarlosGil83, please. And use the hashtag, which is hashtag SMWTO. Now we got that out of the way. Once again, my name is Carlos Gil, and it's so good to be here with all of you. I want to invite you personally, if you have any questions, whether during my session, whether after the session, if you want to stay in touch, my cell phone number is right there on the screen. Make sure that you send me a text, the 646-846-1922. You can also add me on Instagram and Twitter at CarlosGil83. Now, you see some of the different logos on the screen. Michelle read my bio before. I've had the pleasure and honor of leading social media for notable brands such as LinkedIn, Winn-Dixie, which is one of the largest supermarket chains in the United States, BMC Software. And over the last 10 years, I've devoted my career and virtually every single day to building not only a brand for myself, but for clients and former employers. Now, with that being said, I wrote a book. It's called The End of Marketing. All of you here in this room have a copy of that book. It should be in the bag that they gave you when you checked in. The reason why I wrote The End of Marketing is simple. Marketing today is fragmented. Audiences today are fragmented. You heard some of the different platforms that Michelle mentioned. I'm gonna also talk to you about some of those. You're gonna hear over the next 3 or 4 days that you're here, different publishers and platforms speak to you. Because the reality is that today's consumer isn't just on Facebook. Today's consumer is not just on Twitter. They're not just on Instagram. They're now learning about TikTok and going over there. They're getting on Snapchat. And as a marketer, our jobs are harder than they've ever been before. Now, that's one aspect. The other aspect is future-proofing your brand, which is something I'm very, very passionate about. You see, I've had the good fortune that I've spent 10 years to build a personal brand. So anytime I had to look for a job, I had the personal brand to fall back on because I had the connections. Most people that I've encountered in corporate marketing, what they do is they go home at the end of the day, they watch Game of Thrones, they watch reality TV. They're not on Twitter chats. They're not on LinkedIn networking. They're not creating content on YouTube. So they're letting their personal brand go by the wayside because they're investing their time, rightfully so, in their 9-to-5 on their J-O-B. And I learned this in 2008 when I lost a job and then had to rebrand myself, that personal brand is an investment that you make. It's an investment for your future. It's like a 401k account, because every single person that you meet, every connection on social media is an investment that you're depositing in that account, being the social network itself. Now, as I was doing my research around where marketing is headed, and I did about years worth of research before actually sitting down and writing The End of Marketing, much less even pitching it to a publisher, I started seeing this theme of AI, otherwise known as artificial intelligence. Bots. Started seeing at different conferences like this, IBM Watson and Microsoft AI. And I started coming to the realization that as marketers, excuse my language, we're all fucked. Because what's gonna happen in the next, not even 10 years, it's gonna happen like in the next 2 to 3, is automation is going to essentially replace the marketer, the community manager. Let that sink in for a moment. So when C-suite executives get wind that you can now program an AI to do what a community manager has to do, which is sift through content and decide what to post, how to respond, how to be cool, how to be engaging, when yet an AI can just crawl all Twitter mentions and respond, then guess what? You don't need the community manager anymore. When the C-suite starts to get wind that brands like KFC are already creating their own CGI influencers, then guess what? You don't need to hire a YouTuber to create content for you. You create the perfect looking influencer. That's reality. So because I take pride in the work that I do in the industry that I serve and the people I serve, which is all of you in this audience, I said, you know what? I'm gonna write a book that's gonna be the holy grail of social media marketing, but I'm all about real talk. I'm gonna help people future-proof, first and foremost, their jobs. And second, how to stay relevant in what I like to refer to as a noisy digital ocean. Now, I know we just met, but let's get real with each other. By a very quick show of hands, how many of you woke up this morning and the first thing that you did was you went to social media to see what your favorite brand of all time posted? Two of you. Okay, this is really easy. I'm gonna pick on you. You right here, what brand was it? Yeah, no, I think it was you. What brand was it? Technically, yes, but that's entertainment. That's not consumer brand like, say, Nike. You in the back, what brand was it? Sports teams, all right. So look, the reason why I asked this question is because us as marketers, our objective is to do what? To create content, to engage an audience, hopefully, to sell. Thank you. And do we do a good job at that? Let's be very, very honest. What? No. Thank you. I appreciate it. The reality is this. We as consumers, myself included, don't go on social media to consume content from brands, yet we work in the space creating content for a brand. I'm wearing Gucci shoes right now. I don't follow Gucci on social media because the reality is that I know when I go to the Gucci store, they're still going to exist. When I go to Nordstrom's, Ted Baker's still going to be on the rack. However, how do we as consumers typically take to social media? When we have a bad experience, we go to the brand, we tell them about it, we vent, or when we have some of a good experience sometimes, we want to flex, we want to look cool, we show off what we're doing. Some of the times we tag the brand, some of the times we don't. Most of the time, the brand that we're tagging doesn't engage back. That's the reality. And that's where I want you all to realize, before I really jump into this, that marketing has to change. The reason why we are at this intersection that I refer to as the end of marketing is because marketing as we know it is dead. The technologies have changed. The people have changed. You have Generation Z that's now another demographic that you need to focus time and attention on how you engage them. The reality is no one likes being sold to. I don't know a single person that intentionally goes to social media to see a sponsored post from a brand. Most people, what they do when they see a sponsored ad from a brand, they keep swiping. You know what I want to encourage all of you to start doing? Start commenting as your brands in sponsored posts. That's what I want you to do. Because the reality is you're in a giant digital ocean right now where your content's being lost. It's being muddled and muted by the large volume of consumers that are on social media taking a very limited amount of attention away from you. You see, as marketers, we all chase the vanity metrics, the bottom line, the ROI, but in reality, attention is the commodity that we're all seeking. It's not likes. I'm so glad that Instagram is doing away with public-facing likes. I know in Canada, it's already been gone. In the US, news just hit. Marketers are freaking out. Influencers are freaking out, rightfully so. Because why? We've developed this culture that we are scorecarded and graded based on likes. A vanity metric that you can buy, you can game. But I tell you what you can't game is relationship building. Getting someone to be an advocate for you without paying them, something you can't game. So who here in this room has seen the movie Castaway before? Almost all of you? It's one of my favorite movies. So what you see behind me is an example of social media today, the state of social media. You've got Tom Hanks with his hand up in the water waving bye to Wilson. Your social media accounts is the digital equivalent of Wilson, ladies and gentlemen. You're talking to yourself. So when you see that you're not getting the engagement that you want, there's a reason for that. And it's probably because every time you show up on the scene, you're asking of something from your audience, and they perceive you to be selling something to them. So let's take a very quick, short moment of silence for marketers everywhere. Because going forward, you will need to rebrand in peace. And what rebranding in peace means, you need to be savage as fuck. I'm a huge pro wrestling fan. And I was a big fan growing up. In fact, if you turn to chapter 3 and then to marketing, it's my favorite chapter of the entire book. Because I make the parallels and the comparisons to pro wrestling and to the state of social media marketing today. Pro wrestling, as we know, scripted. What's social media? It's scripted. Social media has logos as accounts. Pro wrestling has human beings as characters. Your social media presence needs to now be a person, and you need to have personality. You're gonna see some examples here of some different notable brands and some influencers. You need to have personality, and what I mean by being a digital savage is you need to find ways to stand out, first and foremost. Because in this new era that we're in, you need to adapt and evolve or die. And when you start looking at AI as a threat to your jobs, as a real threat to staying relevant digitally speaking, I refer to this as Judgment Day of AI versus humans, very similar to Terminator. Because once again, our jobs are at stake. Our brands are at stake. Because once AI is able to automate and make tasks easier, then you don't really need the marketer anymore to make the decisions. You need the marketer to program the AI, and then you don't need the marketer to make the decisions. So this is why, ladies and gentlemen, it's extremely important that going forward, you really focus on how to make your brand more human-centric. Because the reality is that humans relate to humans. We are people. We don't relate to AI because we're not robots. Now, what you see here behind me is little Michaela. For all intents and purposes, she's your average 19-year-old hipster on Instagram. She's got 1.6 million followers. She's verified on Instagram. Hell, I'm an author, best-selling author, and I'm not even verified on Instagram. But yet the CGI influencer is. Pretty fucking crazy when you stop and think about it, that Lil Michaela is at Coachella. Lil Michaela is doing collaborations with J Balvin. She's wearing Gucci and Prada and Louis V, but she's not real. She doesn't exist other than online. Because the reality is this, ladies and gentlemen, we live in two parallel universes. There's the real world, which is where we're all at right now, and then there's the online world. In the online world, we all have more friends, we're more popular, more liked, more wealthy, have nicer things. In the real world, we're just us. So somewhere along the lines, Silicon Valley has realized that marketing today is so much more about psychology than it is even sales. And if you develop the perfect image doing the right things, which is what we've seen through influencer marketing, and now you turn that into a CGI bot who's not even real, guess what? You don't need to pay the influencer anymore because you own the likeness. Right here, what you see behind me is the new Colonel Sanders. Do you guys have KFC here in Toronto? Yeah? You see the new sexy millennial Colonel Sanders. No joke, this is the new face of KFC. If you go to @KFC on Instagram, the new Colonel has a six pack. The new Colonel has a side tattoo going down the rib cage. Some agency somewhere like reviewed all like the hot male influencers and said, we're gonna make the Colonel go from being like this chubby old white guy to make him look like Matthew McConaughey and Brad Pitt and put a little salt and pepper in his hair to still kind of make him look like the Colonel. The reality is, once again, brands today are realizing where the shift is going. Smart brands. And I want all of you to be a smart brand. The reality, though, is that going forward, you need to make a human face and voice the face of your brand. And it starts with real people. So when I look at all the celebs online, the Lil Michaelas, the DJ Khaleds, the Kim Kardashians, the Jake and Logan Pauls, when I see these individuals, I don't see a celebrity. I see an individual that has access to the same tools as you and I. I see someone who's giving you and I the playbook for how we should be leveraging social media in our businesses. Because guess what? These quote unquote influencers are all selling you shit. You just don't realize it. And oftentimes what they're doing is they're just selling you on their persona. So why is it that as a corporation, in some cases, million and billion dollar corporation, why is it that we struggle so much with developing personas at our company? The reality is that today people are brands. People buy from people. People trust people. People don't trust brands. They see a brand on social media as an advertiser. There's a reason why I asked you the question before, who woke up this morning and see what your favorite brand posted and no one raised their hand. Now, we're already seeing this happen in the business space. You have business personalities that are selling to you every single day. You see some notable figures here on the screen behind me, Gary Vee, Ty Lopez, Mel Robbins. When you kind of close your eyes and imagine, when you see some of these business personas on the scene in your newsfeed, what are they doing? They're promoting their content to you. They're selling you courses. They're selling you masterminds. They're selling you whatever it is that they have. But what they're doing is they're hooking you with their personality. Because why? You relate to a personality, not a logo. You have motivational speakers, right? Eric Thomas, Tony Robbins, Les Brown. These motivational speakers, yeah, they make you feel good. They make you feel real good. Good enough to swipe a credit card and go to a mastermind. Good enough to swipe a credit card and buy a book. Good enough to swipe a credit card and take action that benefits them and their business. Because they do what? They give you value and they make you feel good. And there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. Not dissing that. Heck, I do the same with my personal brand. But what I would advise all of you is what I advise my clients. Start taking the playbook that these individuals are applying every single day in their businesses and start applying it in yours. You can motivate your audience just like Tony Robbins motivates people to get up off their ass and take action in their lives. You can motivate your audiences the same way. You can educate your audiences instead of constantly selling to them. However, knowing your audience is the first step. You know, we're at right now this intersection in time where as consumers, we have more options than ever before on where we go to consume content. But let me tell you, you don't need to be on every social network in order to be successful. You don't. You know, I'm seeing right now, you have a lot of marketers that are gravitating to TikTok because there's a little bump in engagement, there's less saturation on TikTok. But I'll be the first to tell you, you don't need to be on TikTok if your customers aren't there. You don't need to be on Snapchat if your customers aren't there. Analyze who your audience is first. Leverage the data that you have access to first. You know, what you see here on the screen behind you is your like typical good old American family nowadays. You've got the younger daughter who's on TikTok, you've got the mom who's on Facebook, you've got the dad that's on LinkedIn, probably networking or looking for a job, and then you got the little boy who's on YouTube seeing what his favorite vlogger just posted today. Understanding your audience and who you're marketing to is critical. But I'll tell you what's even more critical, I'll let you guys in on this, it's knowing what's coming next. So many marketers that I come across, and we have these conversations at conferences, dinners, you name it. So many marketers that I know are not taking the time to do their due diligence on what's forthcoming. Right now, I would imagine that there are people in this room that are still trying to figure out Facebook because you have a lack of engagement. Right now in this room, there are marketers who are trying to figure out Instagram stories, Snapchat storytelling. All of that, my friends, is basic. We're in almost the year 2020. Knowing what's next is gonna be what actually helps you go outside of the social media bubble and capture market share that you've lost. First and foremost, don't sleep on YouTube. YouTube is, from my perspective, one of the most powerful social networks that exists. It's owned by Google. It's pretty safe to say, at this point, Google owns the internet. If you wanna be able to get a bump in organic reach, put content on YouTube that teaches your audience no different than influencers are teaching their audiences. Teach about what it is that you do. Have your content go on YouTube with the right titles and descriptions. And what you'll see is over time, when people go to Google to type in, how to buy real estate in Toronto, how to buy insurance in Toronto, whatever it is that you do, as long as you have like the how-to followed by what you sell or what you do, then over time, you'll get organic reach. People, the right type of people, coming to YouTube and or Google to learn about you. And then you've got TikTok. Again, you're gonna hear from TikTok at this conference. Personally speaking, my recommendation to you is proceed with caution if your audience isn't there. Social media, ladies and gentlemen, can be a big, big waste of time if you're not strategic. If you're just chasing every shiny new object because you heard a social media influencer or guru say, hey, go over here, because you're gonna get reach, you're not that guru. That's not your audience. The next is video gaming, esports. It's a big open ocean in that world. And I have Fortnite on here because in the last couple of years, Fortnite has amassed over 250 million gamers for one game. To put it in perspective, Twitter is just shy of 300 million daily active users. Fortnite, 250 million. Video gaming is huge right now. So with that being said, if you are a brand who's trying to reach a younger audience, you don't need to go run off and start up a Twitch account and start playing video games. What you do is you research who are the top gamers, maybe here in Toronto, who are the top gamers on Twitch, who are the top gamers, period, and you go sponsor them. You know, I spent some time with my 13-year-old just looking at what my son does when he plays video games, and oftentimes he's not even playing. He's looking at someone playing video games. It's pretty fucking crazy, if you ask me. He's looking at another kid playing video games, which is gnarly. Most recently, for those of you that have kids or know Fortnite, Fortnite, like, went down for a day. You would think that, like, my son couldn't function. You would think that he like, got heartbroken by his, like, first girlfriend. Kid couldn't function at all. He was on YouTube for like 12 hours watching a live stream of like play-by-play of what's happening in like Fortnite world. You know what those are? Those are moments. Those are moments in time where the right brand can swoop in and participate in the conversations. Engage that audience. Then there's Spotify / podcasting. I was amazed. I interviewed Mike McNano, one of the co-founders of Anchor, which, by the way, anchor.fm, great podcasting platform, just want to add. And I was really impressed when he said to me that the advertising industry in podcasting alone will exceed $1 billion in 2021, which is a year from now. Pretty crazy. And the reason for that is why? Because people are so over being sold to on social media. What social media has become is, in a lot of ways, people showing off, they live their best life, their worst life, they're talking politics, at least in the States. It's pretty crazy. Podcasting, you're able to enrich your mind, you're able to be entertained, which is one of the main reasons why users flock to social media. Start thinking about launching a podcast for your brand, first and foremost. That's a great way to humanize your brand, and or partner up and sponsor a podcast presented by your company. The next is Reddit. What I love about Reddit is that it reminds me of like old school social media. For those of you that are young enough to remember the days in the United States, it was called America Online. Did you guys have that here in Canada? Yeah, was it called like Canada Online? It was AOL, thank God. You know, I was in Salt Lake City earlier this year, no one knew who DJ Khaled was. So I'd be very embarrassed like if no one knew who AOL was. But Reddit reminds me of like old school social media. It's why we took to social media in the first place, and that's to socialize, to meet people, not to sell, and not to self-promote. Now, I had an interview that I did for Entrepreneur Magazine with Aaron Levant. He's the CEO and founder of a platform called Network. They're basically the home shopping network, or QVC, for millennials and Generation Z. They sell like all the Yeezys and Air Force Ones, like really cool sneakers. He's also the founder of ComplexCon. I was amazed when I went to ComplexCon last year and I saw a convention center in Long Beach, California, filled with people, thousands of people wearing the newest sneakers, the newest gear. You had celebrities there and there was marketing talk. And one of the things that stood out in meeting Aaron was he had mentioned this statement here, scarcity. Creating scarcity is what sells. So when you think about creating scarcity for your business by comparison to the world of marketing today, how many of you here are familiar with Yeezys? Okay, So you know Yeezys are pretty hard to come by, pretty hard to find. People will stand in line to buy a pair of sneakers, just like they'll stand in line for the new iPhone. What that is that's creating a sense of scarcity to get people to want to not just buy, but also promote your brand. Which is why Aaron says to know marketing today is to understand psychology. It's once again to know your audience. Now, we have Popeyes here in Toronto, yeah? Over the last 2 months, I can't tell you how many people I've seen posting about a chicken sandwich. It's crazy. I can't even believe that in my profession, I'm talking about chicken sandwiches on a stage. These chicken sandwich battles between like Wendy's and Popeyes and Chick-fil-A. And you know why, once again, there are people literally, no bullshit now, people are killing themselves over the chicken sandwich at Popeyes because they wanna look cool. They wanna have that moment just to post on social media that they got the chicken sandwich. It's scarcity, and it's marketing at its finest because you're tapping into psychology. How many of you saw the Fyre Festivals play out on Netflix and Hulu? Cool, me too. Now, here's what I'll say in full disclosure. I know Ja Rule personally, so I was fortunate to hear the other side. Ja Rule and I recently linked up at a conference in Cleveland, and he said a few things in our, no pun intended, fireside chat that really stood out to me around the state of marketing today. And he first mentioned, when I asked him, Ja, tell me about why Fyre Fest was successful from the standpoint of getting people to buy and swipe a credit card in the amount of $10,000. And he said the following. First of all, it was all about the fear of missing out, the FOMO. If you create an experience or a product that has limited shelf life, that has an expiration date, that you create scarcity around, exclusivity, and you make it look cool, people will buy. And that's what Fyre Fest was. He also said something else that really stood out. People want to be a part of something cool. So ask yourself right now, is your brand cool? Like when you show up on social media, are you cool? Do people want to promote you? Do they want to talk about you? If not, then your objective, ladies and gentlemen, before you post another tweet, another Instagram post, is how do you become cool? The last thing Josh said was, Fyre Festival gave the everyday guy a belonging with the A crowd. How many times do you see someone that you know flex on Instagram because they met a celebrity at a Raptors game? Probably all too often. Or they saw someone at a club and they wanted to show off like, I'm here at the club with so-and-so. All the time. I know I do in my network, all the time. That in itself is an example of marketing today. Because people, again, it goes back to moments, not marketing. People want to be a part of something that's bigger than their everyday life. Now, let's talk about why you're here, which is to improve your social media marketing, I hope. Social media has four key pillars that you need to hone in on, four. Every one of these pillars requires its own strategy. Oftentimes, marketers naturally focus on the content because they think if I create really good content, it's going to get people to convert and my job is done. That's only the first step. Creating content that converts requires creating content, first of all, that's relevant to your audience. It's content that your audience wants. It's content that your audience perceives to be cool. Then there's community. Community are the people that react to your content, but more importantly, they're the few individuals who engage with your content and share your content regularly. You know, I meet with a lot of CMOs, and there's one in particular that comes to mind who I met with over the last year. And she came to me and said, Carlos, we have 30 million likes on our Facebook page, but we get very little engagement. And I was not surprised whatsoever. I looked at her Facebook page. It was like the same 8 people over and over and over again liking posts. So I said to her, first of all, I want to break this down with like no scientific evidence, just very common sense. These 8 people all work on your team. Maybe one's in like PR. And she was like, impossible. I'm like, watch. And I looked up every single one of these people on LinkedIn, and sure enough, they all work for this company. And I said, I hate to be the bearer of bad news to you, but you don't have 30 million Facebook likes. You really have 0. But here's what we're gonna do. And this is where community comes into play. We did a deep analysis of every single person that had mentioned this brand on Instagram in the last, like, 2 or 3 years. And we uncovered that this brand, which is a very powerful financial services company, this brand had about 900,000 mentions on Instagram that this brand had never acknowledged. We then went over to Twitter, we did the same exercise, and we noticed that there was mention after mention after mention that the brand had never acknowledged. Because naturally, what do most community managers do? They respond when the brand is at mentioned or at tagged. They're ignoring when the customer is using hashtag company name. They're ignoring when a customer tags or tweets and doesn't tag, but instead they just tweet out with the company name. So what we did was we started going on offense versus defense, and we started identifying who are the 30 like most consistent people. And hear me out now. We went from potentially engaging 30 million Facebook likes to finding 30 people. How many of you would love to have 30 people every single time that you post on social media share you out to your brands? I know I would. That's actually a lot of people. So I say this because I want you to focus less on the numbers going forward, and I want you to focus on the quality of follower. I want you to focus on the quality of connection, because community is so powerful and should not be overlooked in these times, especially if you're trying to stand out. Then there's consistency. I get asked this question all the time, Carlos, how often should I be posting on social media? And the answer is as often as it takes for you to engage your audience, but make sure that when you're showing up on the scene, you're not showing up with bullshit, meaning you're not selling to your audience. Remove the call to actions, sell less and engage more. And guess what? Having a conversation with someone is a form of content marketing without actually having to create content. And then there's conversion, which is what we all chase. That's the valuable link click, it's the valuable sale. I get it, we're all in business for a reason. We're using social media to sell. But you need to remove sales out of this equation and start focusing more on community brand building. That way, what you do is you build up advocacy. Now, let's talk about Facebook for a moment. Facebook is one of the most powerful social networks that exist around. There's no secret about it. But Facebook is also a business. So if you're sitting there analyzing your own social media and you're wondering, well, why has my engagement decreased? Damn you, Mark Zuckerberg, damn the algorithm. The reality is that you just suck at marketing. But guess what? Once you understand the rules of engagement, then you just play by the house rules. So reality is that Facebook, being a business, wants your ad budget. So give Facebook your money. Spend money on ads. Targeted ads, mind you. So I often compare not just Facebook, but LinkedIn, Twitter, all these social networks, I often compare them to casinos. Because if you understand casino terminology, then you understand that the social networks themselves are the house. The house is not gonna let you build up your own brand and monetize for free on their territory. That's like me going to any one of your offices and saying like, hey, can my office and my employees work out of your office for free? And you're gonna say like, this ain't a WeWork, dude. You gotta pay to be here. Same thing happens with Facebook, same thing happens with the social networks. So with that being said, you gotta spend money to make money. I think that point is probably gonna be hit over the head several times within the next few days. But let's go back to content for a moment. And this is like a judgment-free zone. How many of you are familiar with how Tinder works? A lot of you, okay. Like I said, it's a judgment-free zone, people, relax. We're in this Tinder generation right now. And when you really analyze how Tinder works, it's a dating app, right? You're reacting based on impulse. You're reacting based on what looks good. You're trying to maybe find a date or a mate. And again, you're like stripping out all the context and you're just making an impulse decision at first based on what looks good in your newsfeed, right? For those of you that are familiar with Tinder, see some heads nodding? Cool. Content on social media operates in the same exact way. Social media content from brands is no different than Tinder. You need to date your community before you right hook them and sell to them, okay? So you need to put content in front of your audience that they're gonna find appealing, find attractive, that they're gonna want to stop as you're scrolling through their newsfeed and engage back with you. And how do you do just that? How do you improve your content? Well, you have three options. You can either educate, inspire, or entertain. There's three primary reasons Mine is shopping. There's three primary reasons why people go to social media besides to shop or connect with people. And it's, they want to be educated. And I'm sorry, there's three primary reasons why people go online. They want to be educated. So platforms like YouTube, you go on there, you learn things. Then you jump off and you go back to your life. You get inspired. You go on Instagram, you see meme accounts, you see The Rock. By the way, that's The Rock, that's not me flexing up there. You see The Rock, Tony Robbins, you get really excited. Or you go to get entertained. You go see what Drake's doing, you see what happened after the Raptors game. So start thinking, going forward, what can my brand do to fall into one of these three categories? Every single brand, I don't care what you do, I don't care if you sell funeral services. Every single brand has the ability to educate. Not every brand can be entertaining. I'll give you that. I go to a lot of these conferences and people say like, well, hey, I do this. I'm a roofing business. Like, yeah, it's kind of hard to be entertaining all the time. But every brand can educate. So what do you do going forward to educate, inspire, or entertain? You tell stories. You tell stories that humanize your brand. And right here on the screen, you might want to take a photo of this slide. This is my 7 steps for being a savage storyteller. And let me break this down for you. It starts off with, well, what's your objective? What is it that you're trying to accomplish today? Is it to sell something? Is it to take someone behind the scenes? At a conference like this, I would imagine that you want to show that you are with colleagues, you're having a good time, you're learning things. Whatever your objective is, you need to start with that in mind before you create any content. Then pick your channel. Truth be told, Snapchat and Instagram are not the same. Snapchat content, 10 seconds. Instagram stories content, 15. They're not the same. And you shouldn't be repurposing content either, because repurposing content is a digital equivalent of serving your neighbor's leftovers from a company potluck. You hear me? You don't do it. It's like taking like old poutine and putting it in a microwave and then showing up to a Christmas party and saying like, hey, this is fresh poutine. You don't do that shit. So think of your content the same way. Content should be fresh, should be consumable, easy to digest, just like some good poutine. You guys like how I incorporate a little Canadian-ness into this? Next is select your storytellers. So you don't need deep pockets to hire big name influencers. One, if you want big name influencers, maybe do some trade work with them. If you have some assets of value, offer to do trade. But I would encourage you, and you're gonna see me talk about this a little bit later on in the presentation, I would encourage you to start focusing on creating your own influencers from within, which are your employees. Employees are your greatest asset. If you're not leveraging them to do takeovers of your Instagram account, your Snapchat, then you're really missing the mark on a tremendous opportunity. So engage your employees to be storytellers, and then engage your customers. See, we have access to all this data that exists. What Twitter is, what Instagram is, they are essentially search engines, no different than Google. You can go on Twitter, you can see who's talking about your brand, and when you really start paying attention to who's in your community, what you'll do over time is you'll start seeing the same names appear. And what you want to do is you want to recruit these customers to be your storytellers. It makes your job significantly easier if someone else is telling the narrative of how they use your brand, how they engage with your brand through their voice and their face versus you. The next is storyboarding your content. You really want to make sure that before you start storytelling, you actually have a plan and you don't just look unorganized. You want to have a beginning, middle, and an end. So you want a plan. What's the first thing that someone's going to see when we appear in their newsfeed? And I recommend to you within those first like 2 seconds, bring some enthusiasm and energy. Because if you're dull and boring, you know what people are going to do? They're going to keep swiping. Again, this is Tinder, but on social media. Then you've got taking your viewers behind the scenes. People love to see the inner workings of how your company comes to life, whether it's a small agency, a small business, or a big major corporation. Take people behind the scenes. The last company I worked at before I went out on my own, BMC Software, we started using a combination of Facebook Live as well as Snapchat for recruiting purposes. Every single Friday, we would get one of our executives and we would use these mediums to talk about job openings at BMC Software. It was a way to not just humanize our brand, but to be more relevant and relatable with a younger audience that probably isn't flocking to LinkedIn or Indeed to apply for jobs, but instead could learn about how cool our company is through social media. And then six is ask your community to take action. What do you want your community to do? So many people lead in with a call to action, and what you need to do is you need to realize that if someone has watched your story all the way through, you've done a good job keeping them hooked. So at that point, when you get to the very last piece of content, you need to, at that point, right hook your audience and ask them to take action, whether it's to visit your website, whether it's to come back again tomorrow, share with a friend, whatever it is. And then seven is own the screen. So owning a screen is really tough. Over time, Snapchat helped me become a much better presenter in person and a much better storyteller because it forced me to speak in 10-second increments. That's really tough, and it doesn't come natural to marketers. So I would advise you when you go back to your offices, first of all, identify who within your organization is passionate enough about social media to maybe start doing some takeovers, okay? Who at your organization can be turned into a persona or a character and start creating content around them. Remember, community is king. How many of you throughout your career have heard some marketing guru tell you that content is king? Yeah? I call bullshit on that. Because content is noise. The internet doesn't need more noise. Social media doesn't need more noise. Social media doesn't need another influencer. They already have enough of it. And guess what? As Generation Z grows up, it's gonna get even noisier. It's gonna get even more cluttered. It's gonna be even harder. If you think right now it's hard to get organic reach on social media, I really encourage you to take a step back and do an audit of every social network that you're on and maybe start cutting out the one or two or three that aren't yielding a return for you and focus on the one or two where you can get the highest return on your investment of time and money that you spend. The reason why community is king is because without community, you have nothing. You just have digital noise that no one's engaging with. So again, this goes back to the example I said before. You could either be a brand that says, well, we have hundreds of thousands of followers, we have a logo that people want to engage with, or you can take the few people who actually are customers of yours and advocates and start engaging them directly one-on-one. Now, with that being said, I would encourage you to spend more time having conversations than actually creating content. Like I said before, you don't need to show up every single day and post a new video or a new photo. You can run a poll. You can ask your community open-ended questions. It's gonna lead to them conversing. If you really wanna give your social media accounts a boost, here's what I encourage you to do. You guys want a ninja growth hack? No? Okay, I can go on to the next slide. You guys want a ninja growth hack? Go to your top performing post over the last 6 months on Twitter, on Instagram, on Facebook. Go to your top performing post. I guarantee you, you probably did not respond to every single person on those threads. Don't lie to me, you didn't. So go back and engage with every single one of those individuals that you didn't respond to in real time. What this is gonna do is, first of all, it's gonna get you back on someone's radar, someone that might think that you ignored them and that you don't exist. Two, it's gonna help build that bridge between you and that customer that you might have potentially lost. And three, it now bumps your post back up to the newsfeed organically because now it has new engagement. Now the reality is that social media, my friends, is the wild, wild west. There are no rules. There's no governing body. There's no one saying that you cannot engage with customers of your competitors. You know, I'll give you an example. About 8 years ago, I got hired by Winn-Dixie. They're a supermarket chain based out of Jacksonville, Florida. And I got hired to be their first ever head of social media. I had zero team and I had zero budget. For those of you that can relate, it sucks. And I had to get really scrappy with how we went to market and launched a Facebook page and Twitter account and Instagram and do influencer marketing, which back then was just working with bloggers. Times have changed. And what I did was I went to my CMO and I said, look, Mary, her name's Mary. Mary, you see this on Twitter? Twitter at the time was still somewhat new. I said, these are real people that have tweeted or mentioned us and our competition in the same breath. Some people hate us. Some people love us. Some people hate our competition. Some people love us. But you see, what's happening here is no one is swooping in and engaging. And that's our opportunity to gain market share. And she looked at me and said, you know, Carlos, this is great, but we don't want to poke the bear, like, go back to your cubicle. And away I went. I was much younger in my career, and I didn't have the courage and really the authority, like I do now, to tell her, like, to go pound sand. So I went back to my cubicle, and I started analyzing these trends over and over again. Why is it that at your local shopping mall, Champ Sports isn't swooping in? Back then, when someone was checking in at Finish Line on Foursquare, right? Remember in the Foursquare days, we had all this data of people checking in. And I kept analyzing, like, why isn't Target going after Walmart? Why isn't Walmart going after Target? Like, why are these brands missing this opportunity? Which brought me to this point. You gotta be a digital savage if you wanna succeed and stand out. And what I mean by this is you need to use social listening to identify not just who's speaking about you, but who's speaking about your competition, who's speaking about your industry. Whenever a brand comes to me because they want to work together, and just so you guys know, my agency focuses primarily on community management for brands. So whenever a client comes to me, the very first thing I do is I go on my phone and I go on Twitter and I'll ask them, who are your top 2 to 3 competitors? And they'll tell me. And I very quickly type in their brand name. And this is an exercise that you probably want to do yourself for your company. I type in their brand name and I type in competitor A. And I see, hey, this is how many people are mentioning you and competitor A. Then I go to B. This is how many people are mentioning. And then C. And then there's times where I'll even do mix and match. I'll put like client name and then like 2 or 3 competitors. Because what's happening a lot of times is customers just want to be acknowledged. People want to be acknowledged. So they're going to social media because they had a bad experience with one brand, and then they're creating this open opportunity for XYZ competitive brands to swoop in. That's one. Then you have people who are customers of your competitors that are going on social media and either having good or bad experiences. So again, like I used the example before, in my like supermarket days, I'm like watching in real time people talking about my competition and me wanting to swoop in and engage. So, ladies and gentlemen, be a savage marketer. You gotta be savage as fuck going forward. And I'm gonna tell you something that probably no marketer has ever told you. In fact, if you take this back, and I hope that you do, when you go back to your offices, some of your bosses might think that you're absolutely batshit crazy. But you know what? You're a better marketer than them. So I'm gonna teach you what you need to do to be a savage marketer. First of all, anytime that you go and see the reviews left on competitors' Facebook page, what I want you to do is I want you to swoop in on the bad reviews, and I want you to comment back as your page. I want you to let your competition know that you're paying attention and you're taking action. And quite frankly, you give no fucks because this is business. That's one. Two, I want you to comment on competitor Facebook ads. Have you ever seen a Facebook ad in your newsfeed that comes from a brand that you compete with? Probably. The reality is that what happens is the agencies, and for those of you that are in the agency world, you know exactly what I'm talking about. The agencies that are running your ads for you and doing your media buying, they're using targeting criteria. So they're targeting your customers. It's social media 101. If you want to get Facebook ads in front of the right audience, you just go after people who are interested in your competing brand's audience. That happens. So here's what also happens. Brand will spend thousands of dollars on running Facebook ads. Brand isn't hiring now the agency on the back end to pay attention to who's commenting on those ads. That's your opportunity to swoop in and take market share. It's being a savage marketer. And then there's targeting competitor page fans and followers. So if you really want to win the game of social media marketing, start paying attention to whenever someone's mentioning your competition and start swooping in and have conversations with them. And the low-hanging fruit, ladies and gentlemen, is when someone does not at mention or at tag. Again, from experience, having a client that had 900,000 brand mentions on Instagram, not a single person was ever responded to. I'll give you another very real-life example. As I was writing the end of marketing, I went through and saw a hashtag on Instagram for hashtag I wear Cole Haan. If you are putting a piece of content on Instagram with hashtag I wear Cole Haan, I think it's pretty safe to assume that you're a customer of Cole Haan and that you swiped a credit card and bought a pair of shoes. They had approximately over 400 posts on Instagram, And you know what I did on one Saturday afternoon? I went post by post by post by post. Cole Haan had not commented on a single one of those posts. There were people with verification checks. There were users with hundreds of thousands of followers. And Cole Haan has missed this opportunity to swoop in and engage real customers. Don't let that be your brand. Now, we talk more about being a savage through having a personality. One of the most savage brands that I know is Wendy's. You had this snarky response here from a Chick-fil-A tweet. Is there anything better than enjoying one of our spicy chicken sandwiches on Friday afternoon? Wendy's swoops back in, yes, enjoying one of ours on a Sunday. You've got this tweet here. I want to go on a date with Wendy's and take them to a real burger joint at Burger King. You have Burger King that swoops back in. Treat her like the princess she deserves to be. Then you got Wendy's that swoops back in. If you're looking for a princess, you might want to let it go. Not interested in the frozen beef kingdom. Ouch. So again, what's the key takeaway here? You got to be a savage. You got to have a personality. Now, let's talk about real quick who holds influence over your brand. And that's, once again, two distinct groups of people. It's your employees and it's your customers. So we hear a lot about employee advocacy. Employee advocacy is no joke. It's no lie. It's something that you should not overlook. Because the reality is that your employees at your companies, and quite frankly, all of you in this audience who work for an employer, you all have reach, you all have influence over your collective networks. So you should be focusing on ways, if you want to really put your social media on steroids and reclaim organic engagement, you need to be doing it through your employees first, and then your customers. Now, let's talk about, very quick, the ever-changing role of a marketer. Because again, I mentioned at the very beginning of this presentation that all of our jobs are getting ready to be disrupted. So if you want to be ahead of this curve, I recommend that you be the person at your organization that leads the charge. And don't wait for an outside consultant or agency to come in and say, hey, by the way, CMO, we can go ahead and, you know, outsource all your community management and do it through AI. Instead, what marketer going forward is going to become is a data analyst, taking all the data that exists on social media today and then being able to turn that data into something called knowledge. What do we do with this data? Who is in this collective group of users? Do they have influence? Are they customers? Are they customers or competitors? What can we do with them? Next is AI program developer. Going forward, you will be deputized with programming AI. The shitty part is it's AI that might replace your job. But if you control the AI, then you can stay in control as long as you possibly can from a career standpoint. And then there's brand spokesperson. And this is where I really want to challenge all of you to hone in on. It goes back to humanizing your brand. It goes back to future-proofing your careers and your businesses to stay relevant. Become the spokesperson for your brand. If you really want to get a good laugh, go on Twitter and look up at WinDixieCarlos. You're going to see a much younger version of me, slimmer, no beard, with a polo shirt on and a name tag. I looked like I bagged groceries back then. But what I really was like I was an influencer for the supermarket chain that I worked for, which was Winn-Dixie at the time. And ultimately, that's where marketing will be headed through employee advocacy. It's taking your employees and turning their face and voice into the face of your brand. Now, I got a couple more slides before I wrap up. But once again, I want to invite you, if you have any questions after this, I'm going to be signing books outside, but I want to invite you to text me, 646-846-1922. Also, follow me on social media, at CarlosGil83. Before I flip to the next slide, how many of you know who DJ Khaled is? Almost all of you? Great. Again, I was in Salt Lake City earlier this year. No one knew who he was. I was really embarrassed. You guys, being from Toronto, can probably appreciate this. I've spent, leading up to writing then to marketing and doing this talk that you're all seeing, I spent the last year doing a keynote called What Marketers Can Learn About Social Media from DJ Khaled and Drake. I'm a big hip-hop fan. I'm from Miami originally and love DJ Khaled. So when I go into offices and do pitch meetings, corporate CEOs and CMOs think I'm batshit crazy when I tell them that their brand should be more like DJ Khaled and less like a brand. The reality is that DJ Khaled today is one of the most watched people on the internet. He's not the best looking, not the most eloquent, not the best dressed, but he's real, he's relatable, and he gets people to watch. Which again, if attention's the commodity, we don't want to focus on the exterior, we want to focus on the content itself. So, as we look to wrap up, I want to leave you with 7 keys to success for social media, inspired by DJ Khaled. And the first is why are you on social media in the first place? Don't play yourself. If social media is not yielding ROI for you, if Twitter's not yielding ROI, if you're rushing to TikTok and it's just complicated and your content doesn't look good, then you shouldn't be on there. Analyze why are you on these social networks and go after where your customers are. That's one. Two is don't think like a marketer. Think like a customer. The reason why I asked you the question earlier about do you go online to see what your favorite brands posted is because I know for a fact every single person sitting here is a customer first. So start thinking more like a customer. What is it that you want to see from the brands that you follow? And then give that to your customers from the brand that you manage. Then who are you trying to reach? The reality is you cannot appeal to everyone. Focus on who your target demographic is and create content for them. Social media, my friends, never sleeps. It never goes away, even when you go home on Friday, even when the Raptors are on playing. Social media doesn't sleep. In fact, it typically, like, social media is like the club, right? It's like the VIP section. The club typically turns up really late at night. That's social media. So keep that in mind. You should be where your customers are when they are. Again, if you want to be a savage, if you want to win the game, I don't make the rules, I just play by the house rules. The next key to success is create relevant content that your audience wants. And this is a major key, ladies and gentlemen. The content that your audience wants, you don't know what they want unless you pull them and ask them. Or if you take the time to see your top performing content, then you get a realistic idea of what performs the best. So if memes perform the best, give them more memes. But stop using call to actions like click this, swipe up, comment below. Remove that out of the equation. Engage more and sell less. You've got six, which is be loyal to your audience and they'll be loyal to you. What this means is that if you're paying attention to what your audience is saying, then you should engage with them when they engage back with you or when they mention you. And then seven's the most important of all of DJ Khaled's keys to success, and that's community. Community is king, ladies and gentlemen. Content's the queen. So with that being said, hone in on building your community one person at a time. You know, throughout the book, The End of Marketing, I use this phrase that I'm gonna share with you. Old school rules, new school tools. I'll repeat that again. Old school rules, new school tools. Since the beginning of time, relationships have been paramount to everything that we do. Relationships are how we all got here. In business, people do business with who they like, who they trust, and who they, quite frankly, want to do business with. Again, we're in this Tinder generation. If someone doesn't like you, if they don't think that your content looks good, they're not going to engage with you. They're going to keep moving on. And that's going to affect your bottom line. But I'll tell you something. Keep an eye on the numbers because the data doesn't lie. There's a great philosopher by the name of Jay-Z that once said, men lie, women lie, numbers don't. Thank you so much for your time, Toronto. I appreciate it.